It's been 10 years since the anniversary party.
Right.
I consider that the first film that was actually a real film, or looked like a real film, that was shot on digital. Mm-hmm. You kind of really actually did it right, which nobody was really doing at that point. It still all looked like, it had stuff going on.
Right.
Digital is where we're going, or do you see the end of digital? Recently, Deacon said that he doesn't expect to shoot another Coen Brothers movie on film.
Yeah.
What do you think?
Well, I have a very ambivalent relationship with digital. I think there's no stopping digital, and there are too many economic factors driving it forward, plus obviously the ease that it has, and you know what they call the democratization of cinema that mm-hmm. it's allowed. So there are many good things about it. At the same time, I feel, as I was saying downstairs over lunch, I feel like I'm somewhere in the middle of a pack of lemmings that are headed off the cliff. Mm-hmm. I see the cliff up ahead, but I'm being pushed forward from behind too, and mm-hmm. I'm in the pack, you know? Mm-hmm. And we don't really have any choice. I mean, I would like to see, as I wrote a piece for the New York Times right after anniversary party, mm-hmm. About their different media. We use them for different purposes.
Right.
In different ways. They're two completely different modes of expression. Now, technically, mm-hmm. they have started to look like they're coming together more and more, but there's mm-hmm. still substantive differences. Mm-hmm. And I don't see why they can't coexist. I mean, to a certain extent, they're coexisting now in that I just finished a large film mm-hmm. That we shot on 35mm, but we're going to have about 250 visual effects shots in
right.
it. It's not a gimmick film. It's mainly to create an extension of existing reality, an ice field up in Alaska. Mm-hmm. So hopefully they'll be invisible.
Right.
And so the two technologies are working together. And I mm-hmm. mean, it's stuff that in a purely photochemical realm 10, 15 years ago would have been much, much more difficult, much more expensive to do.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, I like to think that I can work in both media. And I have done things where I felt I could not have conceived shooting mm-hmm. a film with a film camera. For instance, the mock documentary film I did that starred Werner Herzog, Incident in Loch Ness,
mm-hmm.
with the whole idea, the whole framework of the film was based on me going around with a small handheld digital camera like this one,
mm-hmm.
photographing Werner Herzog making a documentary, my documentary about him making a documentary about the myth and the lore of Loch Ness.
Right.
Now, we finished it on a video master, but we made 35mm film prints for distribution because we wanted to bring back a sense of a movie feel to it.
Mm-hmm.
That would have looked not quite the same if it had been done completely in digital.
Right.
You know, video, that is, all the way mm-hmm. through. So I don't know, I see a simultaneity of using both of these. The unfortunate thing that I feel is that we are being compelled by marketing and distribution factors to move mm-hmm. relentlessly toward digital-only cinema.
Mm-hmm.
And in fact, the studios have recently declared that a year from July, they are essentially going to virtually eliminate 35mm prints for theatrical distribution. It's mm-hmm. all going to be what they call DCP,
right.
digital cinema packages.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm not looking forward to that.
So you don't like the projection that much either?
I don't like the projection. I think there are a lot of issues with the projection. I miss the subconscious flicker effect. I miss grain. I miss a lot of things about film.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that they try to emulate. You know, they have, you pick when you're doing a digital intermediate,
mm-hmm.
they pick what they call LUTs, lookup tables,
mm-hmm.
which emulate a certain film emulsion look, and
right.
they're still doing that. Well, eventually, as we have fewer and fewer filmmakers, cinematographers mm-hmm. and directors that have any experience in mm-hmm. photochemical filmmaking at all,
right.
those are going to disappear. And so the digital look is going to become more and more the sort of the default position in filmmaking.
Mm-hmm.
And we're going to look more and more at the celluloid history of film
right.
as an anomaly that lasted for a century. But I think there's going to be a revisionist feel about it as this starts to happen. There
mm-hmm.
already is. A lot of the photography schools, like Art Center and Brooks and
mm-hmm.
some of the film schools that have basically eliminated film, celluloid,
mm-hmm.
as an educational tool, are starting to understand that without the bedrock of what you have in a photochemical film environment, mm-hmm. you know, with, you know, exposure latitudes, f-stops, developing printer lights and things like this, in the digital world, all this data is just sort of swimming around, and it's mm-hmm. all kind of infinitely manipulatable, which is great on one hand, but it doesn't give you any coherent way right. of looking at things or controlling what you're doing. And so mm-hmm. you become sort of prey to sort of some fairly arbitrary things that happen. And it doesn't give you an aesthetic bedrock, you know?
It's so like, you never make a decision, so you don't ever have to really make a decision?
Well, in a way, that's, and you know, a lot of people say that, you know, I mean, there's a whole thing, we'll fix it in post. They're looking more and more at movies as using a camera as a data capturing instrument, mm-hmm. and then I'll make it later, you know, in the post-production suite, however, and that's infinitely doable. But unfortunately, I think what we are lacking, what we lose, mm-hmm. is there's a whole circumstance, an environment of creative experiences that mm-hmm. happen when you're working with the actors, the director, the production designer, the sound department, your own camera crew on the set, on the day, and you're doing it. Mm-hmm. And there is this sort of concerted effort, this sort mm-hmm. of density of creativity that creates an image. And that image has value. I mean, obviously you can change it if you want to
right.
later, but it happens in the moment and in the flow. And maybe I'm just old fashioned, but I believe very much in creating so much of what you want to do there at the moment, because you're in the moment, you're in the flow, it's true. And if you're just capturing data in terms of photography
right.
and you go back 8 months later in a digital suite and you mm-hmm. start putting in power windows and manipulating everything, yes, yeah. you're changing it, but you're not in the same place.
Right.
You know, you're not the same person. You can't recapture lightning in a bottle mm-hmm. that happened 8 months ago. It's different. Maybe it's better.
Right.
I don't know, but I believe that part of a film, what a film is, the truth of a film, is the experience of doing it collectively at a certain time. We all talk about film being a collaborative experience.
Mm-hmm.
But it's also an experience that happens collaboratively in a time, you know, in a moment mm-hmm. together. And I think that is being eroded the more that the kind of free form, free flow right. filmmaking of digital cinema is.
We would never think of taking a Van Gogh and manipulating it or wanting to manipulate it, except for, you know,
some
parody.
People would.
Some people would, I guess.
Some people would. I mean, one of the things I find absolutely appalling is, you know, 20 years ago, there was a huge fight with directors and the GGA and the ASC
mm-hmm.
got involved over colorization of black and white movies.
Mm-hmm.
What's happened in the last 20, 25 years? Directors now, and even some cinematographers are implicated in this, in taking 2D movies that were made 10, 15, 20 years ago and artificially now rendering them into 3D. James yep. Cameron's going to do it with Titanic. Why? There's a lot of money out there.
Of course, Jim claims there are only 20 movies that deserve it.
Yeah, well, and of course, his are the ones. But 3D, the whole thing about 3D, between you and me,
mm-hmm.
it's just a cash machine for the studios. Most of the people I know and respect feel mm-hmm. at least ambivalent about it the same way I do.
Mm-hmm.
And it's very hard to do it well.
Yeah.
And, you know, I've actually written a piece on this in my blog about what happens to your eyes
mm-hmm.
and why this whole thing about people getting headaches and vertigo and things mm-hmm. like that. This is not just sort of an arbitrary thing. There are pure sort of psychoneural reasons why this happens.
Mm-hmm.
In the same way that, you know, psychologists are very loath to have children under 7 years of age look at 3D movies because mm-hmm. the way your eyes connects to your brain in terms of processing information,
right.
and that's all it is. The eye is just sort of capturing the data for the brain to process
mm-hmm.
in terms of the way we see everything, not
right.
just depth. You know, that is still at a formative age when you're 5, 6, 7 years old.
Mm-hmm.
And 3D movies are completely artificial. It's not the way our eyes and brains process the information.
Mm-hmm.
And it sets up conflicting messages in the brain.
Mm.